goes down. Also, those of you online, there's a special place on the online website for you to sign the pew pads as well. The Breakthrough Prayer Initiative is a simple prayer added to our other prayers for God's Spirit to break through anything that holds us captive, so that we can boldly move forward and fulfill God's intention for why we exist as Christ's body right now and beyond. Will you please stand and join me in the Breakthrough Prayer? Almighty God, may your preferred will break through, usher in and accomplish through us your new hopes, dreams, and possibilities, both in the life of our church and in our own lives. We surrender our wills for yours in order to fully follow you. Empower us to always answer, "Yes, Lord, send me."
Amen.
You may be seated. We come into the presence of the Holy God, who may not be grasped, but may be gazed upon, who is not easily understood, but is full of understanding, who does not come at our beck and call, but who is always near. We gather as God's children in confident assurance that God is here. Praise the Lord. We praise the Lord's name. Everyone who served the Lord, praise God today because the Lord is good. God's faithful love lasts forever. We gather one to lift our voices in praise to the one who shaped the earth and the heavens above. Let us praise the Lord.
Oh, God, my Father,
expert in the law, stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to vindicate himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. So before we start, our lovely Miss Tracy Campbell is celebrating her birthday today. And if you're new or haven't met her yet, please meet her. She's also our church secretary, and she does a lot of things for us as a church. So we're going to sing happy birthday.
I've been so many places, and I've seen so many. Such a wonderful thing. I got to tell you, the children's message has already done all of the heavy lifting. Isn't it funny how that happens? And yet, we shouldn't be all that surprised, right? Because Jesus told us that the kingdom of God is made for such as these. What takes so little for our children to understand about the heart of God sometimes takes those of us who have been around a little bit longer, that much longer, to truly understand and bring into our own lives. And so we're going to take a few extra words to talk about exactly what the children heard this morning. What does it look like to become a good neighbor? Well, I'm Isaac. I've met some of you already this morning and have seen some others as we've come to concerts here at the church. Those of you who are here regularly probably know my parents far better than you will ever know me. Becky Hopper comes and plays the organ on occasion. And we moved back to town just a little over a year ago in order to be closer to family. I was born here in Greenfield, but it was never my home. I actually grew up in Kentucky and only moved to Indiana with my wife and children a little less than a decade ago to pastor churches. And Indiana has quickly become our home, and Greenfield as well. But as you can imagine, because you're part of the United Methodist Church, you know that pastors in this denomination move. And not because we necessarily want to, but because it's what is best for the church. And so I have many times throughout my adult life had to go through this process of not only finding a place to live, but wondering what the neighborhood was going to be like. So have you ever had an opportunity or maybe been required to move? To move into a new place with completely new people? And have you ever wondered what the neighbors were going to be like? I mean, most of us, I think, want to have good neighbors, right? We want to know that when we move in somewhere, the people next door are going to be the kind of people that we want to live near. But we've all probably had both good neighbors and bad neighbors. I will say that the day we moved in here in Greenfield was quite an interesting experience, and we did meet the neighbors within 5 minutes. They will remain nameless, but someone accidentally pocket dialed 911. There may have been a slip and fall. We certainly had quite our experience, and the neighbors were sitting across the street on the porch watching everything unfold. Fortunately, they are tremendous neighbors, and we've gotten to know them, and they are wonderful. We've had some other neighbors who we've never known. We lived in some places for years before we ever had an opportunity or made an opportunity to actually meet the people in our neighborhood or in our community or sometimes in our own church. But you know if you've had a good neighbor, don't you? We have a guy that I'm going to just call Ron. That's his real name because I don't think he'll be watching the service. Ron is probably the best neighbor I have ever had. This was up in Fort Wayne, Indiana, where we lived before moving down here. Met him soon after we moved in when I was out in the yard trying to fix something. I think I was unclogging a gutter on the roof, and I was up on the ladder kind of precariously perched, and suddenly I heard a voice behind me, which nearly scared me off the ladder. And I turned around, and there was Ron, my next-door neighbor. He said, "Hey, neighbor, is there anything I can do to help?" And that was the beginning of just a wonderful friendship where he and his wife and Sarah, my wife and I, we would talk as we met outside and help one another, and I've got to be honest, they helped us far more than we reciprocated. He was just one of those guys who was always there, not in a weird, creepy way, but in a loving way, always ready to help, always ready to jump in. And so as we moved here to Greenfield, we had those questions in mind. What were our neighbors going to be like? And this morning, as we move into Scripture, I think this Scripture begs the question that we actually read within it right at the last verse. Who is our neighbor? And what does it take to be a good neighbor? I mean, does it mean that we're just polite to our neighbors? Does it mean that we just wave when we see people walking down the street? I see folks all the time walking down our street that I don't know. They're from somewhere nearby, I assume, walking their dogs, and I wave, and some of them just put their heads down, and some of them wave back. When they wave back, is that what makes them a good neighbor? Is a good neighbor someone who comes over and helps you in a jam because they see that you need help, like, clearly I needed help clearing my gutters? I think most people would say that these things do make us a good neighbor, right? We're being neighborly when we do these sorts of things. But I have to ask the question about the church. Does being a good neighbor mean something different for Christians? See, the Bible tells us that Christians are called to a new way of life through Jesus. And this new way should produce the kind of neighbors everyone dreams of, frankly. Primary evidence that Jesus lives in you is the way that you think and the way that you live. The way that you both think about and respond to God and to other people. So if your thoughts and actions are guided by love, then it shows that God's Spirit lives in you. And this has always been God's desire for his people. It was the purpose of the law to convict people of sin and to show God's standard of holy love so that we might live by it. And Jesus summed up the law when he said the greatest commandment is to love God and love others in Mark 12. But the people frequently miss the heart of the law in their efforts to focus on the letter of the law. They were more focused on making sure they didn't violate something than they were actually following. And this led to some religious leaders and even teachers of law asking some puzzling questions of Jesus, like we just heard in the passage this morning. You see, Luke 19, 25 through 29 recalls the story of one such teacher of the law who approached Jesus with what might seem like a curious question, considering the man's role in his community. You see, he was an expert in the law. He was the one that people would turn to with questions about how to remain a faithful Jew. And Luke tells us that the expert's question was intended to test Jesus in some way. But I think the question itself also tells us a lot about the orientation of this man's heart. What was this teacher really asking Jesus? He asked Jesus about eternal life initially when he brought up the question. In other words, how can we be saved? But his question was not really about how to enter into a relationship with God. You see, this man was already a Jew and already assumed a relationship based on that. He was already a member of God's chosen people, and he was living according to the law of Moses. He knew then, as we know now, that we are saved from our sin and guilt through faith in God's work. He just didn't recognize who Jesus was, and that he would provide a way to cleanse our sin permanently through faith in him. So the teacher's question wasn't really about how to enter into a relationship with God. It's about how a person who is already in a relationship with God should live in order to be found blameless on the day of judgment. He was asking what people inside the church should do. And Jesus responded by essentially pointing out that this man already knew the answer to his own question. He must keep the law, which is summed up by the dual commands to love God and love others, people that Jesus identified as neighbors. So then the teacher asked the real question, who then is my neighbor? In other words, I can get behind the idea that God tells us to love people, but surely there are limits to this. Oh, and by the way, Jesus was crossing every one of those boundaries. This teacher wanted to either catch Jesus in a lie if he said only his fellow Jews were his neighbors, or to get him to admit that he's been hanging out with the wrong sort of people. But instead of answering his question directly, Jesus uses this parable of a good Samaritan to paint a bigger picture of what a true neighbor looks like. Friends, we're going to continue in this passage by reading this parable from Luke chapter 10, verses 30 through 37. Luke 10, 30. Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along, but when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, "Take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here." Now, which of these 3 would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, "The one who showed him mercy." Then Jesus said, "Yes, now go and do the same." see so often in the Gospels, Jesus chooses to help this man asking him a question to discover the answer for himself by first opening his eyes to a wider reality than he was currently seeing. You see, he needed to see things from a heavenly perspective in order to truly understand. But his question, the way it was structured and what he was trying to accomplish, showed that his perspective was really just an earthly one. He didn't have in mind the things of God. So first, Jesus explains why good neighbors are so important. You want to ask who your neighbor is? Well, let's talk about what a neighbor does. Why do we need them? And so in this story, we're presented with a man who's broken and hurting. He was completely unable to help himself, and he was truly desperate. Now, friends, if you manage to make it through this life without ever feeling like this man did, then you are truly fortunate. But most of us experience moments, maybe even whole seasons in our lives, where we are at the end of our own abilities, where we are lost, hurting, where we are desperate for someone to reach out and to help. And so as the story continues, Jesus introduces us a cast of characters who would have been familiar to this teacher. These could be his friends, his fellow church people, even himself. He could certainly see himself in this situation. And as each one is introduced, I'm sure he expected Jesus to say that they were going to be the heroes of the story. Here's a man in need. Guess what? The neighbors have arrived. But Jesus turns this expectation over on his head. You see, these good people, they weren't the heroes after all. In fact, they weren't even good neighbors. So the first that comes along is a priest. This is someone called to represent the people before God and to administer his grace to them. Next came a Levite, or a temple worker. This would be equivalent to someone called to the work of the church. But these people were not good neighbors because they ignored the need in front of them and they chose to distance themselves from someone in great need. Now this was, of course, a critique on Israel's leaders and what they had become. They shunned the poor, the widows, the orphans, and sinners, when these were the ones who needed a helping hand the most. And notice, these are exactly the people that Jesus had been spending his time with. So far from being good neighbors, these characters had in many ways, just like the leaders of the Jews, had become villains of the story. So Jesus offers up a surprising contrast to this in order to introduce what a good neighbor actually looks like. He introduces a Samaritan. And notice he says this is a hated Samaritan, because everybody knew that the Samaritans were hated. These were the people who had chosen to intermarry with other cultures. They were outside of the Jewish community. They were not considered part of Israel, no longer part of God's chosen people. And so when Jesus chooses this hated person as the one who shows what it looks like to be a neighbor, I have to imagine those words started to sink in quickly. And he allows this teacher to answer his own question. Which one of these that I've introduced you to is the good neighbor? And his response is immediate. The one who showed mercy. Friends, we have to ask not just when we move into a new place, but at every moment in our lives, who is our neighbor today? Who is your neighbor? Well, if we listen to the words of Jesus and understand his heart within this, we're going to find some interesting things in answer to that question. You see, your neighbor today is not the one who can return a favor. It's not necessarily the one who's been kind to you, who is just like you, the one who waves to you as they pass by with their dog. Your neighbor is the helpless, the hopeless, the poor, the homeless, the lonely, the addict, the orphan, the widow, the sick, the inmate, the jobless, the less fortunate, all those who are beaten down by life. Your neighbor is the struggling seeker, the new believer, the questioner, the weary saint in the church. Friends, your neighbor is that struggling church down the street or across town. As we heard this morning with the children, your neighbor isn't necessarily just the person next door. God has brought into your sphere of influence, into your life in any way. So we have to ask the question, if this is true, if these really are our neighbors, then what do good neighbors do when they meet someone like this? Well, I think Scripture's clear that what a good neighbor does is that they love them with a God-shaped love, with holy love. As this parable shows us, that type of love is often expressed in a very unique way as mercy. Now, mercy is an interesting concept. It's one that we find throughout Scripture. It's kindness or concern expressed for someone in need. Some synonyms for this are things like compassion or pity. But it can also simply mean to do good to someone else, specifically someone in need. And mercy is an incredibly important concept in Scripture because it represents the very character of God. In fact, back in Exodus, when Moses first encounters the burning bush and he hears from God firsthand for the first time, he is introduced to God as the one who shows mercy. This is part of God's very character. And not only that, love expressed as mercy is something that also pleases God. We read in Matthew chapter 9, as Matthew is called to join Jesus. We read that Matthew invited Jesus and his disciples to his home as dinner guests, along with many tax collectors and other disreputable sinners. I love that word, disreputable. But when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with such scum?" When Jesus heard this, he said, "Healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do." Then he added, "Now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. I want you to show mercy, not offer sacrifices. For I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, but those who know that they are sinners." Friends, this echoes the call of Hosea 6:6, where God is calling Israel to repentance and faithfulness with these words, "I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. I want you to know me more than I want burnt offerings." Mercy, as an expression of holy love, is what it looks like to become a good neighbor. So it's all great to talk about what it looks like, right? But how do we actually do this? How can we be a good neighbor today? Friends, there are a lot of things that we can talk about. I'm just going to mention a few for us to consider today. This first one, I'm going to apologize ahead of time because it's going to sound a bit accusatory. Understand, I say this to myself as well. One of the first things that you can do to become a good neighbor today is to stop accusing. You see, it's so much easier to point fingers and grumble about how people got into trouble in the first place than it is to show real compassion and mercy towards them. And it's a trap that we all fall into. We see someone else who's struggling and we think, "Ooh, thank God it's not me." And very quickly that turns to pointing, "Well, they must deserve it." If you want to be a truly good neighbor today, you've got to stop accusing. Notice that Jesus isn't accusing those he's sitting with. He's inviting them to repentance and faith. The second thing we can do is simply to remember. Remember that you were once in need yourself, and you still would be if not for God's mercy towards you. Ephesians 2 says, "Once you were dead because of your disobedience and many sins." That's a pretty harsh word, right? "You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers of the unseen world. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead." From Ephesians 2. When we remember how much we have been recipients of God's mercy, friends, it should compel us towards one response: to extend that mercy to others. So we should stop accusing, remember where we come from. And the third one's kind of big, because it's where a lot of us get hung up. You can act. You see, mercy isn't just a state of mind, an attitude, or an emotion. It is an expression of holy love for others in need. And our tradition has referred to works of mercy specifically because true mercy is more than just feeling. Now, there are three ways, of course, many ways, but there are three particular ways that you can show mercy right now, today. I chose words that all start with F so that we can remember them. The first is with your finances. Money. Boy, there's a whole lot about money in the Bible, isn't there? Because it so easily works its way into our hearts. We tend to worship it rather than seeing it as God's gift to be used for His good purposes. So if God has blessed you financially so that you can be a blessing to others in His name, then you should give generously to those in need, trusting that God will continue to bless you so that you can be a blessing to others. And don't worry about how people use your gifts. Just be generous. There was a time when I was younger when anytime I would meet with someone asking for money on the street or at a stoplight, I would go through this internal turmoil. What do I do? Do I give to this person because I feel guilty or because I have serious compassion? Do I not give because they're going to use it for who knows what? And one day, God really convicted me on this. He just said, just be generous. Just give. Trust that once you've done that, it's out of your hands anyway. Friends, many of us, particularly in this country, have been blessed financially. But that is not for our own purposes. It is so that we might extend God's mercy to those in need. The next F is friendship. If you want to show mercy today, one of the best ways you can do this is by becoming a friend. It's one of the greatest gifts of mercy that we can offer. It means living life together with other people, really listening to them and experiencing what they experience. It means showing mercy through your physical presence with those who are in need. We all know what friendship is. But sometimes we avoid expressing it because it's just uncomfortable. The third is with fidelity. This means continuing loyalty and support. Now, that's an interesting word. We don't use that a lot these days, except sometimes in the name of banks, right? Or insurance companies. But it means continuing loyalty and support, representing the concerns and interests of those in need by advocating for them in the church, outside of the church, with your friends and family, in politics, with your vote, and in any other sphere of influence that you might have. It means sticking with those in need for the long term, becoming their advocate, working for their better future. So these are just three ways, but it'd be really easy for us to keep that kind of general, wouldn't it? It's so easy to accept ideas like this as kind of good guidance for how to live. But until the neighbor in need becomes real to us, most people will never act beyond the bare minimum. That's just reality. So let's make this even more personal. What might being a good neighbor look like in practice? It might look like waking up at 2 a.m. to a pounding on your door so that you can sit on the porch with a young man next door who lost his dad and is wrestling. It might mean giving half of your meager savings to a friend because you sense God telling you that his family needs it more than you do right now. It might mean holding the hand of a grieving spouse while their loved one takes their final breath. It's choosing to really love people, even the unlovable, maybe especially the unlovable, in their time of need. Friends, this is what it looks like to be a good neighbor. And the fact of the matter is, we don't usually get to choose those situations. God presents them to us, and then He gives us a choice. Friends, because God has shown us so much mercy in our need through Jesus, the simple truth is we should become merciful towards others. Now, I won't pretend that being a good neighbor is easy. It may put you in really uncomfortable situations. It may mean setting aside your plans in order to become available to others. It may mean committing some of your resources to a stranger. It will often mean going unrecognized for what you do. And it will most assuredly mean building relationships with people who are not like you and putting the needs of others above your own. So then why would anyone want to be a a good neighbor? Isn't it much simpler just to stick with waving and smiling and being polite? I'm here to suggest that for Christians, this actually isn't a choice. If we truly love Jesus and we really want to follow him, we don't get to decide whether or not to be a good neighbor. Because real followers of Jesus become like him. And friends, Jesus is the perfect neighbor. He gave everything for us when we needed him most. He held nothing back. It was all given as a gift. So I want to close this morning by asking you to consider a question with me. This is one of those moments for introspection. Now, I've heard it said that when you talk to yourself, it's a sign that maybe you're a little bit insane, but I find something else to be true. Sometimes we need to talk with that inner voice. We need to ask some hard questions of ourselves and then ask God to reveal to us the truth of our answers. So when you examine your interactions with people living in our community, not just your next door neighbors, but in our community, what do you find? When you look at how you interact with all those in Greenfield, Indiana, what do you find? Are you like the Samaritan from the story? Are you the hero? Do you step in when people have a need? Are you available? Are you willing to commit your resources? Are you advocating for them? Are you becoming their friend? Or do you find yourself more often resembling a Levite or a priest in the story? If it's the latter, what would it take for you to become the kind of neighbor who loves other people as God loves you? We pray for you. Father, we give you thanks that you are a God who gives extravagantly. That when we are at our deepest need, you hold nothing back. You have been so good to us, and you continue to lavish your good gifts on your people. But Father, we often fall into this mistake of thinking that, hey, that's just for our own benefit. But you've always intended your people to become a blessing to the nations. Because through this type of generous, loving life, we give praise and glory to you. We point to your character. We help people to see Jesus. Father, we know sometimes we just hold it all back out of fear, out of discomfort, sometimes just out of a lack of understanding. Father, many times we don't even realize that's what we're doing. But you've promised us if we will keep our eyes upon you and trust in what you are doing in us and through us, that you will fill us with your Holy Spirit. So that we might not just look like your Son on the surface, but that we might become like Jesus, loving as he loves. Father, as we consider this morning what kind of neighbors we have been, we ask that you would convict us where we have fallen short. That you would encourage us where we are following you. And above all, that you would open our eyes to see those who would be our neighbors, especially those who are so unlike us. God, would you help us to become who you called us to be as the church? For we ask this in Jesus' name. Friends, let's continue our worship with a time of prayer this morning. Do we have any requests that you would like to lift up for prayer today? Yes, any others? Well, our prayer is not only asking for things, is it? It's also giving praise to God. Do we have any praises this morning? great song about that. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Well, friends, as we consider what we've heard from Scripture this morning, let us now bring that into our communication with God. We have been given such an incredible gift as God's people. This is access to the throne of the Most High. We can come at any time. We can express our needs, express our heart, ask for God's favor, ask for God's guidance, ask for God's mercy. And we are promised that He hears us. So let's lift these up to Him this morning. Father, you've heard these requests that have been voiced, and you hear all those that are just within our hearts. God, you have promised us that you hear our prayers and that you are able and willing to act on our behalf. And so we know that even before we voice these, you are already at work. Father, we ask that you would take these burdens that are on our shoulders, that you would lift them up and replace them with your yoke, which is easy and light. God, we pray that you would break our hearts for our community, that you would help us to see the needs that are outside of our own immediate context, so that even as we lift up our requests for ourselves and our families to you, we might also grieve for our community in need, that we might also lift up these unspoken requests to you, trusting that you are at work in their lives as well. It is because you are good and because you've proven it to us time and time again that we can pray with confidence, knowing that you hear our prayers. And so it's with this confidence of you, beloved God, that we now pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would the ushers please come forward for the morning offering? Thank you. Father, we give you thanks for your many gifts. And we ask now that you would receive these gifts of our tithes and offerings. Would you use them for your kingdom purposes? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please remain standing for our benediction? And if the children are